Conservatives certainly face a bias when it comes to social media platforms. We saw a story from Gizmodo where Facebook said they routinely suppressed conservative news. It was a Facebook staffer. We saw the story. It was actually the podcast I was in. Jack Dorsey said they were too aggressive in how they policed a meme used mostly by conservatives. And then there was a publication in Quillette where they found 22 high profile suspensions and 21 were only on one side of the political debate. But this might actually be backfiring on the left. While conservatives do face a bias and censorship, in all, it seems like conservatives are actually winning the internet. Right, look, people have said the left can't meme, so I think there are very obvious reasons why conservatives do better. And there's an interview over at Vox that goes through this, and I want to read through this. But we also have this story from the Daily Beast. Democratic centrist group launches Twitter campaign to get people to ignore Twitter. Third way is targeting donors, pollsters, and reporters with promoted tweets, telling them what they see on Twitter isn't real. And this is something I've talked about quite a bit. Now, many people say the reason conservative news does so well online is because mainstream media is dominated by the left. So conservatives find their own outlet for sharing information. But one of the things I've kind of hypothesized is that because of all this censorship of conservatives, the craziest right-wingers are gone. And all that's left are the suit-wearing professionals. Meanwhile, on the left, the crazies are running wild, getting away with whatever they want. Thus, you are now seeing a Democratic group telling people, stop, those people are nuts, Twitter isn't real. So let's read through this. Before we get started, go to timcast.com/donate if you would like to support my work. There is a monthly donation option, a cryptocurrency option, a physical address. But of course, the best thing you can do to support the videos is like and comment below, because the engagement really helps. And share the video on social media. Also subscribe if you haven't yet. But let's get back to the initial story from the Daily Beast. Twitter is not exactly known as a platform for centrist middle-of-the-road political discourse. But Third Way, the prominent think tank for moderate Democrats, is hoping to change that. The group is targeting roughly 10,000 influencers on the platform by promoting paid content that aims to change the progressive conversation to centrist chatter ahead of 2020. And they're doing so in large part by encouraging the individuals they're targeting on Twitter to not pay too much attention to Twitter. Checking Twitter might be a quick way to tune into the political conversation, but it's probably warping your sense of the electorate. Third Way's official account tweeted earlier this week, linking to an article in the New York Times. Spot on. This is exactly what I've been saying. I look forward to the Third Way being called conservative now because they're challenging the far left and the regressive nonsense. They go on to say, playing to the far left on Twitter is a surefire way to leave moderate and independent voters at home on election day. Bravo! I agree! This is speaking to me. But you know, preaching to the choir is not going to do much for you unless you can convince other people this is true. They say, for years, Third Way has tried to keep the Democratic Party from lurching too far left. They've done so primarily by pitching lawmakers on the idea that the path to a sustainable governing majority lies in more centrist-minded policies. But with Democratic lawmakers continuing their leftward drift, the group is rethinking what type of incentive structures matter. The Twitter campaign is a recognition that social media conversations and the powerful public opinion shapers who participate in them can be as influential in shaping how lawmakers act as, say, polling data. Except seemingly not Republicans for some reason. And this is evidenced by the fact that you have numerous high-profile Republican personalities, conservative personalities, saying stop the bias, stop the censorship, and where are Republican lawmakers? Some have come out and talked about this. But where are they? Why is it that Joe Biden says his top priority is LGBTQ rights? The left is staring Twitter in the face, believing it's real life, and Republicans aren't paying attention, for better or worse. This may actually be benefiting conservatives because the left, the Democrats, are being driven insane by the media being driven insane. So here's the thing. This all flows downstream. I made a video not too long ago talking about how the media is going insane because their ratings are drying up and no one watches anymore. In response to this, they become desperate in response to them losing ratings. They start making crazier and crazier content. The left-wing politicians see this and think it's real. And then they start pushing the same narrative. Look at Kirsten Gillibrand. She tweeted that the future is female, intersectional, etc. These things are not mainstream. I mean, they're relatively mainstream. They're becoming more mainstream. But for the most part, it's a small group of people who agree with this. And she's polling at less than 1%. on average. I could be wrong, but that's the last I saw. She's not doing too well. So why would she embrace this? Twitter convinced it. It's what people want, but they don't. Polls show us they don't. So let's just wrap up this story from the Daily Beast. They say the group is also targeting users in New York and Washington, hotbeds of campaign donors and other powerful political entities. And they already caught the ire of some progressives. Third ways, so-called centrist solutions are anything but, because they don't actually reflect the center of public opinion. I believe that's wrong, especially when you consider Gallup and Pew, two pollsters, research firms, have found most Democrats want more moderate policy, not more progressive policy. Still, Bennett said he doesn't expect casual Twitter users to pay any attention to what they're doing online. With a Twitter ad, unless you're interested in this tactic, it just sort of flows past. We are not intending to stop people and say, whoa. Here's the thing. I've routinely highlighted a study from the University of Missouri showing that Twitter is amplifying extremists. The centrists can't break through because tepid centrism doesn't work. Like, my channels do okay, but admittedly, I look at these progressive and right-wing channels and I'm like, man, if only I was more hyper-partisan and if only I was meaner. I'm impressed. I've done as well as I have not insulting people or being mean. The reality is, I don't ever expect to be a massive channel with millions and millions of users. I certainly get a lot of views, especially with the, you know, increasing the output, the work I'm doing. Hopefully, what I do will speak to more people that Third Way, for instance, is targeting, because I think they're right. The Democrats will lose if they can't find moderate people. And it's not so much about your position on socialism versus, you know, capitalism. More so that people on Twitter are so woke, they attack each other all day and night. This is one of the biggest reasons why conservatives are winning the internet. The Democrats are being driven insane. But more importantly, conservatives are dominating because they have a unified message. Whether it's because of censorship or otherwise, I don't know. But in this story from Vox, it's an interview, Why Conservatives Are Winning the Internet. A new book explains why digital activism helps conservatives more than liberals. Now, I got to do something here. Take a look at this. Here's the cover of the book. I laughed a lot when I saw this, because how perfect that it's the hashtag symbol right now, as there is a current hoax to try and convince people the hashtag symbol is far right, et cetera, et cetera. Not necessarily aligned with conservatives, but it's funny that that's what they ended up doing. But they bring up an interesting, a few interesting points. Let's just start from the top, because I don't want to miss over anything specifically. But Sean Illing is talking to Jen Schrady. Now, it's really interesting. They have a very progressive bias in how they talk about these issues. But I do think they're right in terms of their analysis, or at least Jen's analysis. She talks about how, she brings up the good things. The Arab Spring, the Indignados, Occupy Wall Street, these big protests fighting for justice. But then she says things started to crumble. There was Gamergate and this explosion of sexism and harassment. There was Edward Snowden and the revelations about the extent of global mass surveillance. And then, of course, 2016 is when we really went over the cliff with Brexit and the election of Donald Trump. Well, some would argue that's still a good thing, because here's the thing. All of these things, are about populism. The Arab Spring, Indignados, Occupy Wall Street were big uprisings. Regular people getting their voice heard and demanding action. Gamergate, whatever your opinion on it, was also a group of mostly non-media people challenging the media. By all means, if you want to get into an argument about what Gamergate was, do so. I'm not here to talk about who was right and who was wrong. Simply that it was one side versus an establishment side. It was anti-establishment, establishment. Edward Snowden challenged the establishment. Brexit, Trump. Populist challenging the establishment. She goes on to say, I was researching digital activism in 2014, and it was already apparent to me, despite what a lot of people thought, that conservatives and authoritarian powers were seizing control of the digital space. Well, I think this is an insinuation about, you know, conservatives being authoritarian, but it's actually right if you break it down a different way. Conservatives are doing a really good job online. Outside of the censorship, they do. And we have data to prove it. I'll get to it in a second. Actually, I think we have it right here. When we look at the top publishers on Facebook, we can see that conservatives actually do really well. In a report from NewsWhip, which I don't have pulled up, they talk about how the Daily Wire is actually one of the most engaged platforms or companies on Facebook. Conservative, the top conservative page, the Daily Wire, getting 139 million engagements. And the biggest left-wing partisan site was The Root with 25 million. So conservatives are certainly doing a good job. Perhaps that's why, then, these companies are so concerned and biased and censor conservatives, because they can see that conservatives do really, really well online. But back over the Vox story, they do. There is one more point that I want to make sure I highlight, but I think I may have passed it up. Here's what she says. Conservatives are generally monolithic in their attacks on, say, Obamacare. The left wants a diverse array of voices. The left tends to want to include a lot of different people and a lot of different issues, and the result is a more muddled message that is harder to communicate. No better example than what's going on in Birmingham in the UK, where Muslims and feminists are fighting because Muslims are protesting LGBTQ education at schools, and a feminist MP, Jess Phillips, came and actually confronted them. And you're at a point now where the left has tried to bring in so many disparate groups, so many different groups, that the ideologies are clashing. Barack Obama referred to what's going on as a circular firing squad. Many of us online refer to it as the left eating itself. The right does this sometimes, but not that much, because the right is more cohesive and more hierarchical, whereas the left is more, you know, anti-hierarchy. They actually are very anti-authoritarian to the point where they don't actually understand the concept of authority as it is. But there are other reasons why, I should say this actually leads somewhere else. When conservatives are less concerned about the health of the, or I should say the emotional state of other individuals, meaning, you know, you're an adult. If you're offended, that's your own issue. People should be responsible for themselves. You end up seeing something emerge that's, I guess I would just say it's meme culture. Conservatives have no problem making a joke, making fun of somebody, and having a laugh. Liberals, on the other hand, are bringing together so many different groups, they're actually scared of offending each other. This has done something else that's helped conservatives. In this story from Mother Jones in April, the left can't meme. How right-wing groups are training the next generation of social media warriors. Memes helped elect Donald Trump. Now well-funded conservative groups are using them to proselytize. Here's the thing. The left can't meme. They've made some, but for the most part, not many good ones. They don't want to offend anybody, so they can't make jokes. They're concerned about giving interviews, and not all of them, just many of the people on the left, or mostly the woke left. For conservatives, they don't really care about offending you, so they'll make a joke, and it'll work or it won't. And this allows conservatives to have more fun and laugh. It's a really weird thing for me. You know, because when I grew up, the comedy was all on the left, and the right was stodgy and uptight. Now it's flipped. Now the left is policing morals. Not all, but like most of them, yes, they're morality police, concerned about offending one person or another. And conservatives are actually the ones making the jokes. Imagine George Carlin today. George Carlin is an amazing, amazing, legendary individual. His comedy was epic. It will go down in history as some of the greatest. But he made a lot of really, really, really offensive jokes. He has one bit where he uses every racial slur in the book. Why is it that the left won't allow that anymore? No jokes, no mean jokes. Look, they're trying to ban Steven Crowder for not even going as far as George Carlin did in the past. And George Carlin was a hippy-dippy liberal guy. What happened where this flipped? I don't know. But this space is giving rise to those who want to have fun. So I tell you this, when a young person online sees memes and they're funny and they think I can play too and people will laugh and high five me, people want to feel good. This is a massive advantage for conservatives on the internet. The left is offended and people feel bad. Who wants to feel bad all the time? Nobody. So there's an interesting post I found from 2016. That kind of talks about why conservatives have done so well online. It's just someone's response on Quora just before the election of Donald Trump. They asked, why does the internet seem so conservative? The response was, it's a direct result of a liberal mainstream media bias. It's kind of like how feminists a few years ago were given a big microphone by the mainstream media. They used it to basically say men are, you know, they said men are really bad. He says, I'm generalizing, but the point is, they sent a very strong anti-men message. Did anyone in the mainstream counter this narrative? No. So what was the result? Normal people had to take matters into their own hands. Memes, YouTube channels, social media posts. They came like a tsunami. Eventually, the backlash became bigger than the original attack. We're saying the same thing with the presidential election. The media is so pro-Hillary that normal people feel an obligation to counter their narrative. That's why Breitbart is one of the most shared sites on social media. That's why Reddit's most active forum is the Donald. That's why there are so many pro-Trump YouTube channels. That's why so many anti-Hillary topics trend on Twitter. He says, if I were a Hillary supporter, I would have no need to be posting here. Her propaganda is everywhere in mainstream mediums already. But because all you get is negative coverage of Trump from mainstream press, people like me feel the need to use social media to publicize facts, stories, and arguments that the media refuses to acknowledge. And that's true. Investors, Business Daily. Media Trump hatred shows in 92% negative coverage of his presidency. This is where they talk about the Media Research Center did a lot of visual spade work. It viewed some 1,007 evening news stories about Trump, about the Trump White House on ABC, CBS, and NBC from June 1st to September 30th. That's the equivalent of about 32.7 hours of coverage by TV standards, an eternity of news time. What they found was, as Trump himself might say, sad. Over the summer, the broadcast networks have continued to pound Trump and his team with the most hostile coverage of a president in TV news history, 92% negative. When this happens, what do you think the result is? Conservatives go online, they talk about what makes them angry, they share memes, they spread videos, they give commentary, and thus you get a massive outpouring of conservative channels. On YouTube, there's one report that shows an analysis of political YouTube. Way more conservative channels than liberal, but liberal channels still get way more views. Now, this is disputed to a certain extent because there's people like Jimmy Kimmel who's included in liberal. But the reason for that is Jimmy Kimmel's commentary and his jokes and his opening monologues are anti-Trump, never pro-Trump. So you see many alternative and independent voices speaking out and challenging the mainstream media. So we can look at the ratings on any given day for Fox News and see that Fox News absolutely destroys the competition. But the reality is, although Fox News is dominating in terms of cable news channels, there's a reason for that. It's because you have ABC, you know, NBC, CBS, The New York Times, The Washington Post, Vox, The Verge, BuzzFeed, etc., etc., etc. You have many, many mainstream left-wing channels and much fewer conservative channels. And to the detriment of conservatives, there are very few actual conservative journalists. And this is a comment. I can't remember who brought this up, so forgive me if I'm not giving you credit. Conservatives don't do journalism. They mostly do commentary. Liberals do journalism. We're seeing far left activism seep into journalism for sure, but those that are actually gathering the facts and reporting do tend to be liberal. Conservatives aren't countering this, they're just commenting on it. And so that presents a big issue. But then you end up seeing what happens is if the media is dominated by liberals, then conservatives are pushing back online and it's working. The reason I wanted to talk about this video is that this is a story from today. I know there are going to be a lot of people on the left who are like, look at the title of Tim's video. Oh, he's clearly, you know, pandering to conservatives. Like, oh, it's a Vox article. Vox wrote this. I am in agreement with their assessment for the most part. Vox wrote an article about why conservatives are winning the internet. Again, while censorship is a big problem, and I absolutely think it needs to be dealt with, partly because it's actually helping them in some regards, not the individuals, but as a collective. Censorship is bad. People have a right to speech, and the principle comes first. But the reality is, what's happening online is conservatives have utilized the tools of the internet way better than the left has. Well, I will admit, while the story talks about how the Quora post, is a huge hub of meme activity. There was one study I read that said a majority of memes come from the Donald is the second most prolific generator of viral memes. The left has r/politics. I swear to God, you go on Reddit and it's a forum for just politics, but it is ridiculous. It might as well just be like r/anti-Trump, right? But what's happening here with conservatives winning isn't just my opinion. And I want to stress, winning isn't black or white. There are, I think, in a lot of ways, conservatives are dominating the internet. And it's one of the reasons they couldn't predict Trump or Brexit, because they're not paying attention to what's happening online. But we also see this Daily Beast story, which I'm very happy to see. Basically, that Democrats are even recognizing how the internet is destroying their party and hurting their chances. Unfortunately, here's what's going to happen. The progressives absolutely have the ability to go viral. Of course they do. To act like conservatives have the entirety of the internet is silly. They're winning the internet, I believe. Vox believes. Many others do. But the left is still successful online to a certain degree. Unfortunately, they're running wild and they can't agree on things. So the internet isn't necessarily acting as a good thing for Democrats. It's actually hurting them. And here's what happens. The most insane hyperbolic tweets are what go viral. The centrists who are trying to combat this have to pay to have their tweets seen to combat the insanity on the left. It's a damn shame. It absolutely is. And so long as the Democrats are fractured, I tell you what, Donald Trump is going to win. The economy is great. The conservative news online is just dominating. While we can certainly see, according to Newswhip, that in the month of March, this is one of the later studies they have because they look back, we can see that there are, you know, CNN, which is left, according to the New York Times, BBC, absolutely. The New York Times is actually pretty okay, but they do lean left. We can see the Epoch Times doing really great, the Daily Wire, Fox News. So there are many, many conservative outlets that are doing really, really well. It's sad to say, the Democrats have the mainstream media, but as the mainstream media is losing relevance, I think they're going to burn out. And as exemplified by this Daily Beast article, when the mainstream media is gone, the Democrats, they're not going to have any successful message. Bill Maher, look at my video from the other day, or my video from earlier on my second channel. Bill Maher calling them out, saying, stop this. They can't help it. They can't. Bill Maher gets attacked by the woke progressive bunch, and the centrists are trying to pay money to try and break through the mold. But it's the extreme lunatics who get the most attention. And if Twitter keeps banning the lunatics on the right, then the people on the right who get attention are going to be the normal professional looking guys who are acceptable. I mean, people. And on the left, you're going to have the wackaloons, the crazy, crazy people who make everyone look nuts on the left. And the centrists try to stop it. But I'll leave it there. Let me know what you think. Do you think the conservatives are winning? I think they are. We'll see what happens. Just because they're winning now doesn't mean it's going to be perfect. There are some who would contend they're losing in terms of censorship. But I would argue that while there are many individuals who have lost and their speech should be protected, as a whole, conservatives are being benefited by some of this. But again, comment, let me know what you think. Stick around, I got more segments coming up shortly. YouTube.com/TimCast starting at 6 p.m. The podcast will be arranged a little differently, but thanks for hanging out, and I will see you all next time.